Bienvenidos, estamos aquí en la Gibuzo Encounter 12, que estamos un poco aquí haciendo los updates y corriendo como siempre, porque aquí pasan muchas cosas y tenemos que hacer muchas cosas rápido, pero bueno, estamos ya al fin. Al principio habíamos dicho que vamos a hacerlo de una forma, ahora vamos a hacer otra. Vamos a explicar cómo lo vamos a hacer hoy, ¿vale? Vale, vamos a empezar. Vamos a empezar entrevistando a Toby de Kingdom Come, de Warhorse Studios, que han hecho el Kingdom Come Deliverance. Lo tenéis ahí, muy simpático. Hi, Toby.
Hello, hello.
Vale, después haremos el paso a las redes sociales y después entrevistaremos a Jaime Altozano para que después, justo después de entrevistar a Jaime Altozano, pues María y Nebukai pues se van a hacer un IRL y os van a enseñar todo lo que es aquí Gipuzkoa Encounter 12, ¿vale?
Exacto. Vamos a ver la zona de juegos, la zona de hardware, vamos a ver un poquito la zona donde están todos los participantes para que, pues nada, os empapéis un poquito de lo que está pasando por aquí y que os entren ganas de venir la próxima vez, ¿no?
Eso es.
Exacto.
Pero bueno, como hemos dicho, empezamos con Toby, porque tiene un poco de prisa, entonces vamos a empezar con él directamente, rápido. Y como sabéis, Kingdom Come Deliverance es un juego que ha triunfado mucho, es un juego que ha gustado mucho, que se ha llevado un montón de buenas notas, ha vendido 1 millón de copias en su primera semana, en Twitch arrasó esa primera semana que era lo más visto. Pero bueno, entonces, un momentillo, que tengo que localizar aquí exactamente. Lo que la gente igual no sabe es que Kingdom Come Deliverance se tiró 4 años para desarrollarse. Uh-huh. ¿Qué se siente cuando finalmente, después de 4 años, sacan el juego?
Uh-huh. So, Toby.
Yes.
I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about yourself or you want to jump directly in the questions.
Whatever you think is interesting.
Well.
So should I say something? Well, I'm Toby. So. Thank you for inviting me to the stream. I'm the PR manager at Warhorse Studios, so I'm the one responsible mainly for the communications, for different events, for the... Some people say I'm the beard of the studio, so that's one thing. And we now successfully released Kingdom Come Deliverance, so the work, my work changed a little bit, depends on like before release, on release, after release, and so on. And I'm with the team, with Warhorse Studios, for almost 4 years now. I started in June 2014 as a community manager. After 1 year, I got promoted to PR manager.
Nice.
And yes, and now I do this now since, I started it in June 2014.
Nice, nice.
Bueno, básicamente lo que ha dicho es que es el PR de Public Relations de Warhorse Studios, que empezó hace 4 años, que empezó como Community Manager y que fue ascendido a PR al de 1 año.
Mm-hmm. So, first question for you. You have been developing the game for 4 years now. So, mm-hmm. How do you feel when you finally release the game after seeing how it has been developing and stuff?
You know, we have different people here in the studio. We have right now 120 people, and of those 120, maybe, I don't know, 30 already released a game, and of those 30, maybe only 5 released a big game. And you can see on the different people how they react to this release. So the big guys like Daniel and Martin Klima and so on, for them it's like business as usual. We know this feeling. It's a hard feeling. It's very like everyone is super excited, but they can work with it. But then on the other hand, you have people like me who never worked in the video game before, and like 100 other, or I don't know, 60 other people here in the studio as well. And for them, it's like really the day on release, we were sitting in front of the PC, right? Then someone pushed the button for Steam release and everyone was waiting for the reviews, and then we were sitting together in the meeting room and the reviews were coming in and we were all reading the reviews together, and then there was like, I don't know, 84, and it was like, whoa! And then there was 67, and it's like, oh, and then they started to like really feel it together, and but overall, of course, we are super excited. You need to understand that we are a young team, pretty much. It's our first game, like for Warhorse Studios. So we were extremely nervous before the release. We were really nervous after release, while release. And now it's getting better because we see that people like the game, that it has a very good reception. And I would say so far so good. Fingers crossed, everything went well.
Yeah.
And now we need to take care of it, of course.
Vale, vamos a ver cómo todo esto que ha dicho lo condensamos en un momento. Comenta que dentro del estudio hay diferentes grupos de gente. Hay gente que ha trabajado, es muy veterana. Está Daniel Bárbara, Martin Klima, que han trabajado en juegos como Mafia, como Highland and Dangerous, o sea, de hace un montón de tiempo. Que para ellos era algo más normal el lanzamiento de un juego, que sí les emocionaba, pero se sabían controlar. Pero otra gente que nunca había trabajado en un juego como Toby, pues claro, que estaban emocionados porque, claro, era su primer juego y el día del lanzamiento, cuando se publicó, estaban todos emocionados viendo las primeras reviews, que cuando eran reviews buenas, se emocionaban ahí, ¡ay! Y cuando eran reviews malas, eran como, ¡bueno! Entonces, eso, ¿algo más me he dejado de todo?
No, así lo has condensado muy bien.
Vale. Desde vuestro punto de vista, Toby, ¿cómo ha sido la acogida de Kingdom Come Deliverance?
So, from your perspective, how has the audience reacted to the game?
I would say very good. That was the when we took a look at the reviews. Some of them were really good. Some of them were really bad, or not really bad, but like average. And the good thing is actually that when people were criticizing the game, they were criticizing bugs, which is a fair thing. It's, of course, it's not cool for us as well. We also don't like them, and we are working on them. We are releasing a patch right now, so for everyone who's looking at the stream, there might be a patch now, I guess. And that's one thing, yeah. But the most important thing for us, that as far as we could see, that most people or most media or the world, most of them didn't criticize the vision of the game, the style of the game, the design of the game, at least not the overall concept of it. So that's a really, really, really big thing for us, because in the beginning of development, people were saying, realistic thing, and no one wants this, and Czech history, and who's interested in Czech history, and and we were really like, this Kingdom Come, I mean, when you play it, you will see that it's very unique in the way it plays and it works. And the good thing is that no one actually said this is a bad game. Vision is bad, the design is bad, it's just not fun. Yeah. So this is for us extremely important. The bugs thing is, as I said, that's something what we also don't like and we're working on. But that's good. And what's also very nice to see is that the media reviews and the user scores are pretty much matching. So when you have, I don't know, we have currently something like 75 or 76 average score that on Metacritic from media, and we have I think 78 or 79 from user score, so which is pretty much the same, which is a big thing. I mean, that's a good thing, because usually when you take a look at the games, you see a scissors that, I don't know, let's say, I don't know, PUBG or something, media likes it a lot, people say it's not good, and
yeah,
that's not nice to have the scissor thing, but yeah. But as I said, we are very happy with the reception so far.
Bueno, que básicamente que lo que les ha sorprendido es que, vale, si la gente ha criticado los bugs, que es algo que ellos también aceptan y que están trabajando en ello. De hecho, ahora mismo están lanzando el nuevo parche, el 1.3, si mal no me equivoco. Y que bueno, que quitando eso, lo que sí que les ha gustado es que la gente no ha criticado el concepto del juego. Que al principio, cuando anunciaron el juego, toda la gente decía, no, es que un juego realista no va a vender, la gente no lo quiere, tal cual, pero que es algo que ahora nadie ha criticado eso y parece que eso va bien. Sí, ¿no?
Sí. Exacto, que ha puesto como ejemplo otros juegos, por ejemplo el PUBG, que tienen ese efecto tijera que lo ha llamado, que por un lado puede que esté muy bien aceptado por el mundo mediático, pero que por otro lado está muy criticado por los jugadores. Sin embargo, ellos no han tenido esa situación y pues bueno, están muy contentos. Siguiente pregunta.
Vamos a ver. Bueno, ya me ha pasado. Cuando la campaña de Kingdom Come Deliverance en Kickstarter se lanzó, ¿teníais esperanzas en que el juego saliera? ¿Hubo algún momento en el que dudasteis de que finalmente se pudiera hacer o que fallase algo en algún momento?
So when you launched the Kickstarter campaign some time ago, were there any doubts about the release of the game, or did you expect this acceptance by the audience?
Yes and no. So when we were going, before we went off on Kickstarter, we were certain that this will succeed, that the project will succeed, because otherwise we would not do it. I mean, why would you do a Kickstarter when you think this will not make it anyway, right? So, but what we didn't expect is that after back then in 2014 in January that we wanted 300,000 British pounds, and we got them in, I don't know, 36 hours or so, and this is something we did not expect. So in the end of the project, after 28 years, after 28 days, after oh 20 whatever the Kickstarter month, we had 1.1 million. So people were throwing the money on the screen. No, we're just joking. But for us, this really was a huge thing because it was for Kickstarter. For us, was sink or swim. If the Kickstarter would fail, we would not talk to each other today. Yeah. So. This was a huge thing, but Kickstarter works that you are selling promises, pretty much. So we were promising a game or a vision. We were talking about something we want to produce. We had some like vertical slices and some prototypes, but nothing playable. That's why we started to produce an alpha versions, 5 in total. And in October 2014, so that's roughly 5-6 months after 7 months after Kickstarter, we had the very first alpha, and it was of course a nightmare. People were flying and everything, but it was we wanted to show the people that this game is still existing, that we are working on it, that this is how we have it right now. It's buggy, but we will work with this again.
Yeah.
Which I see now that bugginess seems to be our trademark somehow, but this will one day this will end as well. However, we did 5 alphas, then there was a beta and so on and so on. And in the beta, this was the first alphas were just very small parts and some village, and you can see a little bit bow shooting a little bit. Yeah, but really just like not like no deep gameplay mechanics. Mm-hmm. In the beta we had a big quest line for the first time there where you had to do several things. You had to talk a lot. Yes. And you had to do this investigation kind of style game. And this was the first time we said, okay, well, this is now the, now we can see if the people like it or not. Is it too much talking? Is it not too much? Is there not enough action, for example? And and we even added a questionnaire to the game, to the beta. So we had, I think, roughly 30,000 beta players. And the questionnaire was filled out by 8,000 people, which is a huge number for lovers of statistics. Very good. Thank you, Chris. this is a huge number for the lovers of statistics, and we were asking, is it too much talking? What do you think? What do you think about the combat? It was clunky back then, but we were asking the community what they think about the game. And back then, the people appreciated what we were doing, and they said, oh wow, this is very unique, of course, but go on, just do it, right? And we said, we took the information, we tweaked here and there stuff. And in the end, we have Kingdom Come Deliverance. And what is really interesting, I think it was even in Spain, and I cannot remember one of the, I don't know if it was Tide Juegos or someone, I cannot remember anymore who it was, but one of the chief editors there, he was at our preview event, and he was talking to me, and he said, yeah, he is a Kickstarter backer, so whenever someone tells me that, I'm shaking hands, saying... thank you very much, because of you we can be here today. And he said he's a backer, and I asked him, so what do you think from Kickstarter to now? And he said that Kingdom Come is almost exactly what he imagined when he was backing the game. And this is for us the best thing to hear, because that's good. That's really great. We hope that the people got the idea, and that we hope that the people that we could deliver our vision or our promises into a game.
Mm-hmm. Uf.
Well, that's a lot to translate.
Vamos a ver. Dicen que, bueno, que cuando sacaron el Kickstarter, que no esperaban tener una acción tan grande porque empezaron a ganar dinero ahí.
El primer mes, ¿ganaron cuánto ha dicho?
Un 1,1 millones, sí.
Sí, una locura.
El dinero ahí tirándose, tal como lo ha hecho él. Vale, entonces, pero ahí estaban vendiendo el sueño, ¿vale? Estaban vendiendo el concepto. Entonces ellos, para que la gente viese que era real, fueron desplegando diferentes betas. Las betas eran cosas muy pequeñas. Eran muy pequeñas. Es que pasa por aquí la gente hablando y tengo que ponerme... Pero bueno, Y entonces, pero bueno, al final consiguieron sacar una beta que había un poco de campaña, y esa beta un poco más ampliada, ahí hicieron un cuestionario para que los que pues, estábamos probando el juego pudiésemos valorar cómo, si había mucho diálogo, poco diálogo, si mucho combate, mal combate. Entonces, lo que trabajaron con eso fue para, a partir de ahí, desarrollar el juego completo, y lo que sí que les ha gustado mucho es ver cómo la gente que probó la beta esa ha visto que lo que ellos pensaban que iba a ser el juego realmente ha sido lo que finalmente han conseguido.
Exacto. O sea que han cumplido las expectativas de lo que estaban vendiendo inicialmente, ¿no?
Sí, estamos resumiendo mucho. Si sabéis inglés, os tenéis más detalles ricos,
Sí,
pero...
Popitín está haciendo un trabajazo en el chat, está comentándolo bastante, así que muchísimas gracias, Popitín, de verdad. Muchísimas gracias.
Vale, bueno, hemos comentado que ellos han consiguieron 1 millón y pico en muy poco tiempo. ¿Crees, Toby, que ahora Kickstarter es igual? ¿Hay más facilidades? ¿Es más complicado?
So you started, you launched the project well, some time ago already, so 4 years ago. Do you think that launching a project now in Kingdom Come, sorry, in Kickstarter is as or can be as successful as it was some time ago, or do you think that now is a bit more difficult to get like the resources or the money itself from people?
Whenever someone tells you to that your project is not worth it or that you cannot make it or so on, then just do it. I mean, I'm not the biggest fan of believe in yourself and you will do it, but sometimes it works out. And in our case, people told us that we should do Facebook games because these are cool right now. And
Oh.
we said, no, we don't want Facebook games. We want actually something on PS4 and Xbox One X. We want Xbox One, we want something on PC. And Kickstarter was our only hope back then, actually. Right now, there are way more pages than Kickstarter, so there are many, many different crowdfunding pages, which is a little bit tricky because it splits the audience who is willing to pay some money for a cause to support projects. But I don't think it's dying. I think you still, if you have a good project, you can do it. However, Kickstarter is, it's not a self-running thing. It's not enough to just put a video there and then go on. So you need to really think through what you are presenting, how you are presenting it. You need to have some really strong campaign. And I'm not talking about money. Of course, money is also a thing which helps, but I'm talking about you have to have a strong personality. You have to have a very good idea. You need to be able to present it. Communications are extremely important in that. So find someone who's like to can talk to a crowd,
Someone like
and go
Toby.
for
Someone like Toby,
it. If you want to hire me, click here. No, I mean just to answer your question, yes. I mean, of course, it's still possible. I don't think it's. You know, there was a boom. There's no boom time anymore of Kickstarter. It was. This is already past, right? This is a true thing. But I don't think that Kickstarter or all these crowdfunding campaigns are gone. I actually think what is nice about crowdfunding campaigns is that they took a little bit the. How should I say? They took a little bit the power of publishers to say yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, no, and it opened the market for way smaller companies with some smaller 2D games, some colorful crazy ideas who'd, I don't know, so like really crazy games where bigger companies would say no, we don't want to fund this because they are usually following trends. And this is a great thing because then all of a sudden there were, if you now took like take a look at Steam and the top 100 or so. Yesterday, I think so it's not crowdfunded, but it's also a smaller project. Juchel was released right now, a Czech game, which is really, really great. And I think these crowdfunding pages are helping smaller studios definitely to achieve or to release a game. That's a good thing.
Vamos a ver cómo traducimos todo esto. A ver, que sí, que ahora que hay más plataformas de Kickstarter, eso hace que la gente
De
se...
crowdfunding, ¿no? Más
De
que...
crowdfunding, sí. De que se disperse más la gente. También entonces lo de Kickstarter tampoco es poner un vídeo y ya está, y decir, darme el dinero. O sea, es poner un vídeo, hacer una comunicación, necesitas a alguien que esté ahí atendiendo a esa campaña de comunicación del Kickstarter o del crowdfunding. Entonces, el boom ya ha pasado, el boom del Kickstarter ya ha pasado. pero sí que ayuda al Kickstarter a que juegos que las compañías podrían no seguir porque no son tendencia, pues sí que salgan adelante.
Exacto. Y luego, bueno, también ha hablado de a ver, ¿cómo lo ha dicho aquí Popitín? Lo ha dicho muy bien él también. ¿Es un combo particular único? Ah, bueno, sí. Bueno, sí, sí. Realmente sí. Exacto.
Bueno,
exacto.
Y como estamos un poco de mal tiempo, sobre todo Toby Kistikir, vamos a, ya que ha comentado las compañías, ¿cómo fue aliarse con la distribución para que la distribución le hiciese Koch Media?
Yeah, so how did the relationship with Deep Silver and Koch Media start? How did you end up with this, distributor?
Yes. Yeah. I understand. How did it start? I mean, in some meeting room, I guess. I don't know exactly how it started, but of course, we are extremely happy to have Deep Silver or Koch Media, which is Deep Silver is the gaming brand of mm-hmm. Koch Media. Mm-hmm. And we are extremely happy to have them because thanks to them, actually, we are able to have the game in all the countries, in all the stores, in your favorite Spanish game store and so on. This is something we would mm-hmm. eventually be able to only with a lot of hard work, and since we never did it again, they helped us, for example, to to meet the PlayStation guys in San Francisco. So we got a real email, not info@sony.playstation. So that's something good. So yeah, we definitely share or are extremely happy to have them, as they released many games already. They are pros in Europe and the world, and they helped Kingdom Come a lot, of course. While we kept all creative rights. So we have our game, we have our own PR team, which is me, so and some other people here next to me, and we have a very strong position in the deal with Deep Silver, which is good for both sides, I think. And they help us a lot in marketing, PR, distribution, and so on. And in the end, we are very happy that we have them. And who knows, maybe this continues.
Bueno, que empezó en una sala, supone que empezó en una sala, pero que sí que les ha ayudado mucho, sobre todo a la hora de poder llegar a todo el mundo a la vez, poder reunirse con Sony, por ejemplo, para que no tener el info@Sony tal cual.
Eso es.
Y poco más. Toby se tiene que ir, así que le vamos a hacer una última pregunta así ya rápida para que se pueda ir tranquilamente. Uh-huh. Vale, estamos ya pensando en el siguiente capítulo de Kingdom Come. ¿O vamos a terminar primero de pulir este?
Mm-hmm. So, are you working on a new chapter of the game, or are you waiting until you polish this one?
We are right now, of course, working on polishing. And as I said, there's this patch going out right now. Mm-hmm. So we will take care for a longer time on Kingdom Come Deliverance, definitely. And then we have some DLCs in planning, but we have no specific time frame, no public time frame at least. Mm-hmm. So we have it in mind. There are some stuff from Kickstarter we have to deliver as well, of course, mm-hmm. because there was just some, we said this a year ago already, that unfortunately there was not everything, we couldn't put everything into the game, mm-hmm. but we didn't forget about these things. We just have to bring them a little later. So, but you know, still again, I don't want to say like excuse this or mm-hmm. something somehow, but we are a small studio, so we need to take the steps one after the other. So we release the game, now we have to do the bug fixing, and then we continue with the DLCs and all this kind of stuff. So yeah, there's definitely something planned, but we are focusing on Kingdom Come Deliverance. There are no future projects yet, only some stuff around mm-hmm. Kingdom Come.
Vale, pues eso, que están puliendo el juego, que ya en el futuro, bueno, antes de que salgan los DLCs tienen que terminar de traer cosas que prometieron en el Kickstarter, pero que eso, que ahora mismo están centrados en eso y que ya en el futuro, pues ya otros temas.
Y pulir también, ha dicho, los fallitos que tienen y tal, o sea, sí, perfeccionar y seguir con los DLCs más adelante.
Uh-huh.
Pues así nada.
Toby, we know you have to leave, so...
No, we can continue. So far, the people are not here, so if you want, let's continue.
So, we have a lot
unless,
of... Yeah, go ahead.
Unless you have no questions anymore.
Yes,
then
I have another one. Yeah. parece que hay otros proyectos que utilizan CryEngine que mm-hmm. son que parece que están teniendo muchos problemas. Por ejemplo, Star Citizen.
Mm-hmm. Uy. Epa.
EP, da igual. Bueno, ¿es tan complicado trabajar con CryEngine?
Yes. Yeah, it is very complicated to work with CryEngine, or as it's as they say.
I would say it's complicated with all engines. Whenever you go to an engine provider, they say they have the best one, and all the others are complicated. But I mean, you get used to everything. By the time we were choosing the CryEngine, we were certain that this is the only engine that is able to create the vision we wanted to have, or was able to create the game we wanted to achieve. And yeah, we are happy. Of course, we had to heavily adjust the engine. It was just not made for open world RPGs with millions of trees and thousands of NPCs. So we have to have, like, our programmers are working. We're tweaking it as well. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we used it as good as we can. And yeah, we'll see what the future brings. Mm-hmm.
Bueno, pues que sí, que CryEngine es complicado, pero que bueno, que él piensa que cualquier motor gráfico es complicado. Entonces que sí, que CryEngine han tenido que modificarlo mucho porque no está pensado para hacer MMOs grandes ahí, ni juegos con muchos árboles y tal y cual. Pero que bueno, que al final lo acaban haciendo. Uh-huh. Ya que tenemos tiempo para otra pregunta, pues habrá que hacerle una pregunta improvisada. Está habiendo una polémica con el tema de que el juego es tan realista que no hay personas de color, porque en Bohemia no había personas de color, no hay niños, entonces eso ha suscitado cierta polémica. Desde el estudio, ¿cómo lo ven?
So, we have heard that the game is so realistic that there are no, like, people from other ethnicities, and there are no children around, so how have... ¿Cómo era la pregunta?
¿Cómo ha reaccionado el equipo a esas críticas?
How has the team reacted to these kind of critiques?
I mean, we know what's super interesting that I don't know. We are creating the game we want to create, and it's not like it's not like we don't hear the criticism. So of course we heard the criticism. We take whatever criticism is coming and trying to use it as much as possible and see what's true, what not, and then in the end decide how it is. And I think we made our homework. I don't think we have to be that we are. You know, in the end we need to also understand that this is just a video game, and what we are doing is an interpretation of something. So there's no one, neither we, neither historians nor books, can say how it was 100% by that time, right? So of course these things could be true, these could be true, but we didn't do anything on purpose to, I don't know, do something bad to someone, or to push any idea, or to follow any crazy ideologies or something like this. This is just not true. We never did that and will never do this. It's just to the best of our understanding, with the help of historians, museums, architectures, people who are taking care of the churches here and of the places. This game takes place something 50 kilometers south of Prague. We went to the places, we talked to the people, we asked them what do they think, we talked to historians, to universities, and in the end we created what we believe is a very good interpretation of medieval Bohemia.
Bueno, pues que básicamente que bueno, que ellos han hecho lo mejor posible que podían, el juego lo más real posible, preguntando a historiadores, a universidades, a gente que está actualmente por Praga y tal. Al final ellos se han centrado en encontrar su historia sin querer ni criticar ni hacer ninguna apología de nada, sin querer achacar nada. Simplemente ellos se han dedicado a hacer un juego, y hasta que también hay que entender que también es un juego, o sea, que tampoco muchas veces la gente se vuelve loca cuando es un juego.
Exacto. Y que luego también lo que han hecho es, bueno, fueron a visitar el sitio donde se desarrollaba toda la historia, hablaron con la gente de allí, hablaron con historiadores, con universidades, simplemente para hacer una réplica exacta de lo que era, ¿no? La historia. No querían alterarlo tampoco, porque al final es un videojuego que es eso, muy realista.
Sí. No sé si el chat tiene alguna pregunta, pero...
Exacto. Si el chat tiene algún tipo de pregunta, este es el momento para lanzarlas.
Tenía otra pregunta preparada.
I don't know if there is anything else you'd like to add. Christian has another question.
¿Cuál es la característica que a ti personalmente más te gusta del juego?
Yeah, so which is the characteristic that you like the most? Yeah, the feature, sorry, about the game.
I'm a big fan of the combat system, as I'm playing Kingdom Come for 4 years already, 3.5. I really like the combat system, and I can see how it get better and better and better. Mm-hmm. What I think is most interesting, though, is that fighting is a big thing in the game, but that you can get out of your problems with speech. And this is, I think, is very interesting, that you can solve many problems, many quests by talking your way out, by bribing someone, by sneaking somewhere else, and I think that's interesting that Kingdom Come offers you like a buffet of different stuff, and there's this one quest, and now choose whatever you like is or whatever you think is good, and we mostly or usually only tell you the most obvious, like there is the steak, but take whatever you like. Go for it.
Pues lo que le gusta es el sistema de combate, le gusta mucho. Lleva 4 años jugándolo, entonces sabe cómo luchar como un campeón. Pero que lo que también lo que le gusta es que el juego da posibilidades de hacer las cosas a tu modo. O sea, ellos te ponen un camino que puede ser más o menos claro, pero que tú puedes hacerlo como quieras, o a lo combate, a lo sneaky o como tú quieras. En el chat han hecho una pregunta.
Han hecho un par, de hecho, 3 preguntas. El señor Yokagi dice: pregúntale qué lenguaje de programación usaron.
Eso, bueno. Preguntar si quieres, pero...
¿Cómo se dice el lenguaje de programación en inglés?
Programming language.
Programming language, does that make any sense in English?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, so which
C++.
C++.
If you want to go, if you want to work at Warhol Studios, learn C++. But it depends. I think there are other languages here as well. We created our own as well. There's like for the AI system, we have like some visual thing, but some our own programming language. But C++ is the main programming language.
Bueno, que C++ es C++, es el lenguaje de programación. Que ellos han llegado a desarrollar un lenguaje de programación propio para el tema de la IA. Pero que vamos, que si queréis trabajar en Warhol Studios, C++ es el camino.
En el currículum, chavales. Siguiente pregunta, dice Madlets: ¿cuál ha sido el mayor challenge a la hora de desarrollar este juego desde un punto de vista técnico y creativo? Which has been like the greatest challenge?
Yeah, I understood.
Challenge? Yeah. The
I learned Spanish in school. I'm just not good at answering, but I understand most. So, you know what's the biggest challenge in game development, no matter if creative or technical, is always you get to a point where you think there's nothing worse than this. And then the next day you come to work and there's something even worse. So whenever you think you went over the mountain, then there's an even bigger mountain behind that.
Yeah.
So, you know, there are different problems. I mean, whatever, like, it's hard to say. Optimization is always hard. Frames are always hard. What's the hardest is when you have to scratch something. So we wanted to have a horse which is more like something like Tesla automobile, more can automatically go on the road, which it can slightly, but we wanted to have it even more sophisticated, which will help you, like that it can even a little bit fight with you with kicks and so on. And then we had in the end had to scratch it because the automatic horse was colliding with even the smallest object, like little stones. Then we said, okay, what will we do? Will we delete this object, the collision of the object? But this means that when Henry goes there, you will go through the stone. If there's no... So this was legal, like, and then we said, well, we have to scratch it. So this is something which is... Or the dog companion for something, which is something we will bring later in a DLC, but it's a pity that we had to do it, that we had to scratch it earlier. So, you know, there's no specific thing I can tell you what was like the one problem, but I mean, if you take a look at Kingdom Come now, so it's maybe bugs right now. So, but again, we are working on this.
Okay.
Vale, pues que dice que es que no hay ninguno en concreto, porque tú llegas un día y dices, este es el mayor problema que pueda haber en este mundo, pero al día siguiente hay uno que es más grande todavía. Entonces ha puesto ejemplos de que, por ejemplo, querían hacer un sistema de automático de que el caballo fuese por el camino automáticamente, pero que se encontraban con problemas y que para solucionarlo, tal cual. Entonces lo que se les hacía duro es tener que quitar cosas, porque por ejemplo, como el problema del caballo se les atascaba mucho, al final tuvieron que quitarlo, y eso es algo que a él le parece duro, pero que bueno, que al final es eso, que no hay una cosa en concreto, sino que al final
¡epa! La emoción.
Maybe what I can add as well is that when you're creating a game, usually we have different departments and every department is doing their specific job, and in the end you have to put it together, and in the end you see what is eventually colliding with each other. You see that a feature is not working with another feature because it enables each other, and so on and so on. So at the end, putting everything together, what you can like a thumb rule, the last 5 to 10% of game development is always the hardest.
Vale, pues ha comentado que para poder extender un poco más la respuesta, un poco más todavía, es que al final lo que puede ser más complicado es que los diferentes departamentos funcionan más o menos separados, y que cuando tienes que acabar juntándolo todo es cuando hay más problemas, porque al final una característica de un departamento puede que choque con otra y la inhabilite. Entonces, que la última parte del desarrollo es la más complicada siempre.
Y bueno, pregunta Popitín, que por qué no se ha hecho una, o sea, que no se pueda jugar en multiplayer el juego. Bueno, if you were considering a multiplayer option in the game.
No. But that's the easiest answer. But we were in the bag when we were, like, in years ago when we were thinking about Kingdom Come. We thought about how could you implement it, and then we said, okay, if you implement it, it doesn't work with the current game, so it must be a simplified version of the combat, for example, simplified version of other stuff, because there's a question of milliseconds in the combat with the time slots for blocking and so on. And then we said, let's just focus on Kingdom Come, and then after we will see. But there's no multiplayer planned at all.
Okay. Do you have any time to answer a couple of questions, or?
Go for it.
Okay.
Three questions.
Okay.
Había inglés ahí abajo.
Sí, pero primero estas, vale, ¿no? Sí. Que están en orden. Well, they are asking, how did you get that super sexy beard?
And a girl is saying that, so thank you very much. Hard work, but you know, I started this in February last year, and the time span between no beard, like between teenage boy and nice mustache, there's an extremely long time in between where you look like a creepy guy who's like really a very creepy guy who's in the night with a black coat, and yeah, so it, very long time, it looked very strange, but now I'm happy with it.
Bueno, a ver cómo que dice que mucho trabajo duro, pero que el mayor problema es ese momento en el que, porque claro, pasas de tener una barba pueril para llevar esa barba maravillosa que tiene él, pues hay un momento intermedio en el que eres un poco creepy, que parece que vas con una
la típica chaqueta por la noche a asustar a las chicas, vamos.
Exactamente.
Exactly.
Next question.
I did not do this. I just look like this.
Okay. They are asking if you had any problems with the problemas de creatividad para crear el juego. Any problems with the creativity when you were designing the game?
The only problem was that Daniel Vavra and Victor Botzan, Daniel Vavra is the creative director, Victor Botzan is lead designer, and the only problem is that only those two guys knew how the final product will look like, so they always had to explain to the people why they should do this. And there's a funny thing for those who played Kingdom Come, there's a quest where you have to get drunk with a prize, and this is like a super funny quest, and most of the people say it's best quest ever. But the problem is it requires a lot of animations, a lot of cutscenes, a lot of mechanics and so on, so the people were saying it, why the hell are we doing this? That's not fun at all, it's just too much work, and the people will not appreciate for 5 minutes of slapstick fun. And Daniel was we have to do this, it will be great in the end, believe me, it will be great. And now people are saying best quest ever, and it's like, so it was, the creative trickiness was that only two people
knew how the final product looked like. Mm-hmm. And they always told the developers, then of course there's some creative talk and changing ideas and so on. But yeah, so this was sometimes Daniel had to be, Daniel is a very, very stubborn person, and for a good reason.
Yeah. And last question.
Bueno,
antes
vamos a traducir.
Perdón.
Que dice que el mayor problema que había era que solamente dos personas en todo el estudio, que eran Daniel Babra y Martin Klima.
Víctor Botzán.
Ah, Víctor Botzán. Vale, es que eran los tres jefes, vale.
Designer.
Yes. Yeah. El diseñador. Ellos dos eran los únicos que sabían cómo iba a ser el juego. Entonces tenían que transmitirles todo el rato todas las cosas, y cuando estos tenían alguna idea de tal, decía, llegaba Daniel Babra y decía, no, eso así no, tiene que ser así, 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 y será una buena idea. Y sí, aunque de estos no se lo creían, pues al final realmente sí, porque por ejemplo ha puesto el ejemplo de la misión esa del borracho, que estos lo veían y se quedaban un poco así, y Daniel Babra decía, sí, tiene que ser así porque va a funcionar. Y funcionó.
Eso es.
Que para algo trabajó en mafia, Daniel Babra.
Claro. And last question, what game served as an inspiration when coming up with concepts for Kingdom Come?
Definitely Morrowind, Skyrim, Witcher, of course, the usual suspects, right? Mm-hmm. But in all design industries, no matter if cars or new cell phone or whatsoever, you take what you like from the others, you get inspiration from other products, games, whatever, mm-hmm. and then add your own spice to it, what you would improve, what you think should be different, and so on. So Kingdom Come has some things from The Witcher, like the storytelling, eventually the open world feeling kind of Skyrim, if you want it like this. But I think it also has a lot of Red Dead Redemption. When you are in Kingdom Come, you're driving your horse, and there's for some time there's only forests and fields. And in Red Dead Redemption, you have also this atmosphere of Western, where you have like this prairie, and all of a sudden there's a house, and you take a look, and there's some chest and so on. So, and then Dark Souls hard combat. But you know, in the end, though, it's very, I think, not so easy to compare it to other games. When I say it's like Skyrim, then I'm wrong. When it's like Witcher, then I'm also wrong. So Kingdom Come is extremely unique in what it does. It has some inspiration from other games, but I think that, and I'm not saying this because I'm the PR guy, but I'm saying that from me as a gamer who plays games for over 25 years now, mm-hmm. that I think I've never saw an RPG like this before.
Uh-huh. Bueno, pues comenta que sí, que a ti hay referencias de los juegos habituales, que serían Skyrim, que serían incluso Dark Souls, ahí por el combate, tal cual.
The Witcher, sí.
The Witcher. Incluso Red Dead Redemption, que le gusta mucho el tema de que vas por caballo ahí viendo todo el paisaje maravilloso y ves una casa y te metes en una casa y un cofre. Pero que al final, cuando desarrollas un juego, al final, aunque tengas unas referencias posibles de lo que has conocido, tú lo que haces es meter tu propia esencia del juego. Uh-huh. Y que es lo que ellos han hecho con este, con Kingdom Come Deliverance.
Exacto. Así que...
Exacto.
Exacto. bueno, os voy a poner el Twitter de Toby, por si le queréis dejar el follow, ¿vale? Spam,
sí.
spam.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Tiene un gran GIF, tiene un tweet anclado que es brutal, ese tweet, que es que el del día del lanzamiento, uh-huh. Que el GIF lo hizo cierta persona maravillosa que también tiene barba y que está por aquí. Y sí, soy yo. Pero bueno, y que bueno, que nada, que muchas gracias uh-huh. a Toby por permitirnos hacer estas preguntas. Que sepáis que Coach Media nos ha traído cosillas también de Kingdom Come Deliverance aquí para que...
Oh, very good.
De auténtico cuero. También tenemos el... Oh,
oh, nice.
Christmas package.
Oh, I want that one of those. I want.
And, of course, Savior Schnapps.
Oh. No.
Bueno, nosotros no tenemos eso, pero tenemos también pins muy, muy molones, muy guays. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I can top that. Yes. The Kingdom Come.
What's next? This, but we have this, like a mouse pad. Do you have this?
I can find something. I have... A warhorse.
Oh, come on.
Well.
And a battle axe. So I think I won.
Yes, you won. You completely won. Anyways, thank you very, very much for the interview and for your time.
Mm-hmm.
You definitely won this this fight. And I don't know. Muchas gracias a todos por haber estado en el stream. Seguimos ahora con todo el tema de redes sociales y...
Sí. Si quiere... si quiere decir algo a la comunidad, el
If you want to say something to the community, then the people that are watching
I want to say thank you very much for supporting us. Even though this sounds cheesy, but this not only Kickstarter, but also after Kickstarter, when we are on our homepage, now with purchasing Kingdom Come Deliverance, you are helping a small studio from Central Europe, Eastern Europe, create games. And yeah, thank you for your help for making this happen, because without the community, there would be no Kingdom Come Deliverance.
Thank you.
Pues nada, que gracias a todo el mundo por hacer posible este juego, por el Kickstarter, con la página, comprando el juego ahora, y que muchísimas gracias a todos.
Muchísimas gracias a todos.
And if you don't buy the game,
y si no compráis el juego, hachazo.
That I will come at the night with the half shaven beard.
No, please no.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyways. So thank you very much, and comprar Kingdom Come. Tenéis que comprarlo y jugarlo todos en stream, ¿vale?
Exacto.
Well, so bye bye. And talk to you later.
Bye bye. See you.
Bueno. Y ahora nosotros tenemos que seguir de alguna forma.
Sí, pasamos a la bandera y ahora os vemos.